Thank you. Welcome to the seventh meeting of Constitution Europe External Affairs and Culture Committee. Members may wish to note that Mr. Golden is attending the Standards, Procedures and Public Appointments Committee this morning and will be joining us a little later. Our first item on the agenda is a decision on taking business in private, and are we content that we take item three in private? Thank you. We are all agreed. So we are also invited to agree to consider the pre-budget scrutiny report in private at future meetings. Are members content to do so?
Yes.
Thank you. We now move to agenda item two, which is pre-budget scrutiny, cultural sector funding. As part of the pre-budget scrutiny work, the committee has been looking at continuing impact of COVID-19 on the culture sector and its longer-term future. Today, the committee will hear from the Cabinet Secretary for the Constitution, External Affairs and Culture on the evidence the committee has heard over the past month. And the Cabinet Secretary is, we're hoping to be joined by David Sears, Head of Sponsorship and Funding, Scottish Government, and Bettina Sizeland, Deputy Director for Culture and Major Events, Scottish Government. And we hope the officials will join us at some point this morning. But Cabinet Secretary, can I invite you to make an opening statement?
Can, thank you very much, and very good morning to you all, including Sarah Boyack joining us remotely. Good morning, convener, and thanks for this, my first taste of the pre-budget process and the opportunity to discuss the culture sector. As the committee will be only too well aware from the evidence you've seen, the COVID-19 pandemic has hit the culture sector harder than most. In July this year, 70% of organisations in the arts, entertainment and recreation sector reported a decrease in turnover compared to 31% of businesses for the economy overall. Since the start of the pandemic, the Scottish Government has provided £175 million to the culture, heritage and events sector. That's far more than we've received or are still due to receive in consequentials for cultural recovery from the UK Government. Providing this support has been a lifeline to Scotland's venues and organisations, and in particular to the freelancers who are such a crucial part of the creative economy. The culture sector is not alone in facing a fragile recovery. The same is true of travel and tourism, for example, with the premature end of furlough as a support from the end of last month. The impact of the pandemic, however, is such that it will take some time for cultural activity to return to former levels, with the added factor of the new barriers that Brexit is causing for artists to work in one of their biggest markets, which is the European Union. Yet despite this, culture has continued to play a vital role in people's lives during the pandemic, through its positive effect on mental health and in bringing people together in different ways. We've seen an acceleration in online performances and an increase in the proportion of people, particularly amongst the under 45s who engage with culture digitally. As you also heard in your earlier evidence sessions, the pandemic gives us the opportunity to view things with fresh eyes and perspectives. We are preparing plans for a cultural recovery and are not seeking merely to return to the status quo. There will be new ways of doing this, as so many cultural organisations and freelancers have demonstrated during the pandemic. New opportunities to build world-class businesses, for example, in the screen industry, which has such potential to grow in terms of employment and skills. New opportunities to reconnect communities across Scotland using the convening power of culture and events. And to enhance Scotland's international profile through cultural diplomacy and exporting our best cultural products and services. Our cultural recovery plan will be at the heart of economic and social transformation to ensure that we build a fairer, greener Scotland with equal opportunities for all. Convener, as your predecessor committee heard, the final budget of the last Parliament was intended to stabilise core funding for the culture sector in the midst of the pandemic. We are now at a different stage where, with many cultural organisations not yet out of the woods, we can nevertheless start to plan for recovery. And this first budget of the new Parliament for the coming financial year will be in the context of that transition. We've committed in the programme for government to three-year funding deals for cultural organisations which are core funded by government to aid their recovery. Further decisions on that will be taken as part of the budget to be announced on the 9th of December. The committee will, I'm sure, be only too well aware of the challenging outlook for all public expenditure and the tough negotiations I and my Cabinet colleagues will face before final budget decisions are taken. I'll welcome the committee's views on future priorities in discussion this morning and in the letter to you and the letter you will send me as a conclusion of the pre-budget process. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Cabinet Secretary. You mentioned the three-year funding commitment in the programme for government, and you mentioned that was for core organisations. It was a theme that came through in all of the work that we did, including with community organisations. So are you able to say a little bit more about the vision for that and what difference it will make and how that will impact on community-based organisations as well?
Yep. Well, the first thing to say is I'm delighted to be joined by David Sears, the Head of Sponsorship and Funding, and Bettina Seisland, the Deputy Director for Culture and Major Events, who are very much involved at the technical level within the civil service of considerations like this. But it seems an obvious and very understandable demand from organisations to have a degree of at least medium-term financial security, also allowing people to concentrate perhaps on their core cultural roles and not having to spend what for many might be a disproportionate amount of time when measured against their wish to be delivering culture as opposed to securing funding. So I think the three-year approach we're taking is one that will be hugely beneficial to the organisations that will be impacted by the change. And it's very much a work in progress. I don't know if there are colleagues who are joining me who have anything to add. I should say this is the first time I've taken part in pre-budget proceedings before a Scottish Parliament committee, and I will be endeavouring to answer every question that you may have. We may hit on areas where it is not my specialist knowledge. I will defer to colleagues from the civil service, and if there's ever anything else, I'll be happy to write to committee to fill in any gaps, and of course, as ever, happy to come back at any stage, convener.
Thank you very much. That's very helpful. Cabinet Secretary, I don't know if any of your officials do want to come in on three-year funding at this stage.
Good morning, everybody, and morning. Apologies for being late. We were sat outside for about half an hour, so anyhow, we're here now, so lovely to meet you all. So my name is Bettina Seisland, as Cabinet Secretary says, and I think just to add to what Cabinet Secretary says, the PFG plans for 1 year set out our initial thinking on short-term recovery. We're currently working on a cabinet paper which will set out both our thinking on short-term recovery for the sector and longer-term recovery and renewal to make sure that we both protect our core cultural organisations, but also we make sure that we continue to grow world-class opportunities that are available to all.
Thank you. I'm going to move to questions from the committee and can invite Ms. Boyack to ask questions, please.
Thanks very much, convener. And can I also thank the committee and the technical staff for enabling me to join you all virtually this morning. Cabinet Secretary, many of the cultural organisations we have spoken to were grateful for the support they've received during the last few months, but they highlighted two things. Firstly, that they were very worried about the coming months, not just in the pandemic, but the period after. And they were finding it incredibly hard to plan ahead without multi-year funding. And that related particularly to venues, both large and small, who've also lost their reserves through the process because they'd used the reserves, many of them, before they got funding. And secondly, on a slightly different issue, many of the smaller groups, while welcomed the fact that there were funds available, felt that the complexity and the lengthy application forms were totally inappropriate and in some places actually stressful and just not possible for the organisations to fill in, given the lack of professional support. There was really two questions. I'm wondering if you and your officials could pick them up. Thank you.
Thank you.
So, thank you, Sarah Boyack, for the question. Can I reflect on the focus group evidence that you took as a committee, which I've read in full? And I think there's some very helpful insights from those that took part in the process, particularly around the approach to budget and to making seeking to draw down Scottish Government funds. I think there are definitely lessons to be learned. I think committee members will understand that there is a balance to be struck between ensuring that funds are dispersed on an equitable and on a logical basis, which the organisations in charge of dispersal can then satisfy people like yourselves as to how this is operating. And at the same time, to try and do that in a way which is, well, obviously not disadvantageous to smaller groups. And I am very cognizant of the fact that the larger an organization gets, the greater the capacity it will have and experience to be able to satisfy the criteria for financial application. And pointing, as Sarah Boyack has done, to smaller organizations for whom there is not the comparable capacity to apply for funds. There was some of the feedback in the focus group evidence for people having to make multiple applications and having been turned down, and then having finally been accepted, receiving a lesser sum that they had applied for. I think that's very helpful to understand that that is the reality for many people in the process. I also observed that there were examples given in evidence to you where people had said that the system that they were involved in had worked well. So I don't take the view that the system is not working. I think the system is working. But I'm very keen to discuss with colleagues as we move forward, because the paper that was just described by Bettina is at its heart about how do we help the cultural sector bounce back. And if people are finding it difficult to access funds, they're going to find it incredibly difficult to do so. So it's something that I'm wanting to discuss with officials as part of this wider cultural recovery approach that we are going to be taking in the months ahead. And I think we definitely should be listening to the voices who have given evidence to yourselves. And to my mind, it's a really good example of the symbiotic relationship I hope we have with you as a Scottish Parliament committee, being able to identify the lived reality in the sense of these cultural organisations for us as government, to be able to listen to them and work out if the systems that we have in place are as fit for purpose as we can make them. So it's a two-part answer to your two-part question, Sarah Boyack. It's, I am aware of the issue. Thank you for the evidence about that. And it is something that I am considering together with colleagues as part of the cultural strategy that we are considering right now. Because if anything, our work has to be guided by continuous improvement. And if there is improvement that we can make, we should do that.
Okay, Ms. Boyack.
Thanks. That's very helpful. I think in particular for those smaller groups, in terms of the resource, it's got to be a robust and a transparent process, but it's also got to be workable for them. The first part of my question, I was asking about the multi-year funding, and I think you mentioned that in your opening remarks. I mean, you can understand for venues, whether it's large or small ones, if they're doing touring events or they've got a plan ahead, recruiting staff, that issue of multi-year funding is obviously going to be quite a big one. Did you say in your opening remarks that you're actually thinking moving towards that? And would that be for Scottish Government funding? Would that link to Creative Scotland's funding as well? Because I understand they're doing a review. That was one of the things picked up in our evidence. Wondering if you or your officials could maybe comment on those issues, both about the multi-year angle, but also about would that fit through into Creative Scotland's funding as well?
Okay, so I'm going to have to defer, I think, to David Sears on that question. But you know, we are very keen to try and make the three-year funding approach workable. And on the detail of that, I'll ask David to contribute to the committee.
The SNP manifesto commitment was a three-year deal for organisations co-funded by the Scottish Government. That will include Creative Scotland, therefore. And in such a deal, and I think, as the committee's heard, I believe, from Creative Scotland, they are, in response to the criticisms they received last time they put together a regularly funded portfolio of organisations, they have been doing a review of funding. So what we will need to discuss with them is how a three-year funding deal gives them the certainty of funding and how they, in turn, pass that certainty on to the organisations that they fund in the context of that review.
Sarah Boyack, I'm happy to, off the back of this exchange, write to the committee to outline further details about this, because you're probably asking yourself to what extent will that then roll out to the organisations who receive their funding. I'm in a slightly awkward position, as I'm sure you will appreciate, with this, in as much as we have agencies that are funded by the Scottish Government but are quite rightly at arm's length from Scottish Government, and it's not for ministerial direction about everything that they do. I think that would cause you concern, and it would cause me concern. It would certainly cause them concern. But I think between ourselves and the likes of Creative Scotland, who I know have already given evidence to you, we can provide some supplementary background between ourselves that will hopefully fill in any gaps that you may have on that specific question.
I think that'd be very useful, because of the, it was quite a large number of the organisations that gave us evidence during the last few weeks. Absolutely. Thanks, Convener.
Thank you, Ms. Boyack. If I could ask a supplementary in the back of that, Mr. Robertson, you mentioned the round table that we did have with the smaller cultural organisations, a very diverse group of cultural organisations, many of whom were also working in the sort of wellbeing area of community involvement. One of the things they did point out was that other funders had been very dynamic in the response to COVID. They had been proactive in contacting them, and they had been keen to get that help out the door. But many of them felt, a distance from Creative Scotland and didn't feel that they had that relationship. And I wonder if that's something that you would maybe ask Creative Scotland to reflect on going forward.
So yes to that specific question, but the more general point that you made about cultural organisations being able to access other potential funding streams from other parts of government, I think underlines one of the central considerations that we're making at the present time in relation to cultural recovery and the approach of the Scottish Government to that, which is, rather than understanding it simply, and I hope we don't, in isolation, culture and the arts, in government, a culture directorate, that we think of culture more generally as having an impact across people's lives and across the work of the Scottish Government. And I'm giving a bit of a sneak preview here. I've got to be careful not to do too much of that. But one of the significant considerations that's going into the recovery strategy is to mainstream the importance of culture right across Scottish Government. And so that obviously impacts on health, as an example, Convener, which is the organisation that you cited. And perhaps one of the advantages of taking an approach like that is it will show how different funding streams are dispersed, what people's different experience is, for us to be able to work out, are the criteria different? So is that a reason why people are having different experience, or is it just the nature of the agencies and organizations that are involved? And to me, that is a perfect example of taking a cross-government approach where we view culture as being relevant in all of the areas of government, that if we are able to do that better in some parts of government, that we can learn to do that better in others. And that would definitely be a learning, to use an Americanism, from that process that I think would be beneficial to cultural organisations that have perhaps had a different experience.
Yeah. I just not to ensure I'm not misrepresenting the evidence we took, it wasn't so much about different government funding streams, it was about other funders such as the Big Lottery Fund or Robertson Trust and other funders of that nature that theme was coming from.
Understood. I think when I gave evidence last time before the committee, I had benefited from the experience of recently visiting the postcode lottery. and was interested to note that they, as an organisation, have regular community accessible events where people who are interested in drawing down funding can learn about the process and can understand the best ways in which they can apply. They're almost helped through the process. So the default position is we wish to support community organizations in the case of this this body. And I think perhaps it's a lesson that we can also look at is how these other bodies further than government do the work that they do. Obviously, we are government. This is public money. It's quite different. And you would be the first, and quite rightly, to say, well, hold on a second. You have, quote, lowered your standards for financial compliance and transparency and so on. And so I wouldn't be wanting to do that. But I'm very seized of the opportunity, I think, that we have to learn lessons of best practice and not just from within government. So I've widened the scope, convener.
Thank you. Can I bring in Dr. Allen, please?
Thank you very much. I was curious to pick up on some of the things that were touched on by some of the people who have given evidence to us about their view of coming through the experience of the pandemic, and specifically thinking of museums and historic sites. So I just wonder if you could say anything about how the budget will reflect some of their experience. Obviously, emergency funding has been provided, but as has been mentioned, a number of organisations have talked about the challenges ahead, not least the challenges caused by or caused to the fabric of sites and buildings yeah. by them not being in use. So I just wondered if you could say anything about specifically what your thinking is about how to help that sector.
So I'm sure you've been well advised about the projected, the real and projected loss of income amongst a variety of cultural organisations, including those that are funded directly from the Scottish Government. And that is very much at the forefront of our minds. I would just make a general point. I think we, on the one hand, have an opportunity to try, and I'm speaking as government, and any influence that you could make on the public would be welcome in this regard. I think if we can help, we need to help those organisations directly, but these are organisations that also receive support from the public, visitors to their sites in the case of attractions and historic buildings that the likes of HES have a responsibility for. And I'm very keen for us to be as imaginative as possible about how we can drive up their income to help fill the gap that the pandemic has caused. So I think there's two sides to this. One, what is it that Scottish Government can do? And I think you know the headline numbers, and we've shared with you, and I know some of you have asked parliamentary questions where we have detailed the amount of money that has come out from the Scottish Government to try and help with this. But at the same time, I think one of the areas that we need to do more is to help encourage the public to make the most of these cultural sites. That will help with economic recovery and income for the organisations in question. And specifically on the point of the material state of some of the cultural real estate, I'm sure that's probably not quite the right way of putting it, but all of the places of historic interest that we know, many of them, given Scotland's a historic nation, are very old. And we have very stringent and correctly so health and safety standards for people who are going to visit old castles or stately homes and historic sites. And we're at a stage where this has been reviewed in past months, and I understand that the recommendations from this review process, and this is specific to your question, Dr. Allen, is being discussed by the board of HES this month. So it's something that you will probably be able to get more specific information on the fabric-related issues. I'm sure we all agree we would wish these places to be able to open in full as quickly as possible, and that hangs together with the point that I was making more generally about encouraging public access and uptake of our cultural sites. So there's more information to come on that question, but we are very much seized of the difficulty with which a number of organisations are facing because of the drop in income.
And on that point, specifically on Historic Environment Scotland and their historic real estate, you'll be aware that a number of us have asked questions about this without asking about specific sites. If they're meeting about this, are you hopeful that we will get back to something like the number of sites open that we had pre-pandemic?
I, in all candour, I can't answer that question, Dr. Allen. I'm not privy to the report that is being presented to the board. It's an example of the separation of powers, if you want to call it that, within the cultural sector. I'm very interested to learn what the conclusions are. I would want to be assured that everything is being done to make sure that the restoration of these sites is able to proceed at pace, but also, as I'm sure you are, very keen to make sure that people who visit these sites are doing so with the appropriate safety standards being maintained. I can't give a sneak preview of what the board might be learning, because it's for the board to learn before myself and colleagues, or indeed yourselves, but I will endeavour to ensure that you have as much information as quickly as I and you can receive it in the form, whether it's a parliamentary question or we can write to you and share that information.
I'm very grateful for that. On the budget, coming back to how the budget will recognise how we do new things, again thinking of perhaps the museum sector here, but there's obviously been support for the things that the museum sector and the gallery sector have been doing in the digital sphere. Some of that situation has obviously not been of their making, but they've made the best of it. Thinking more positively about the opportunities that sector has, will the budget recognise the fact that museums and galleries are doing things differently? I'm not just thinking of the move to digital here, but also perhaps thinking about the fact that they have plenty of stuff in their vaults that nobody ever sees, that I'm sure they've now been thinking about how to bring that to a wider audience as well.
So yes is the short answer. But in expanding on that, I think it behoves us all to try and help and support those who are delivering this, whether it's museums, whether it's the cultural or organisations from a management point of view, is to reimagine the cultural recovery that we're all in favour of. And that is to not seek to simply go back to where we were pre-COVID, but to realise that much has changed. And you make the point, and the point is well made, that we are enjoying and consuming culture in ways that we didn't before, and that we need to think both on a policy and on a budgetary approach what difference that should make to our thinking. So yes, we're alive to that. Yes, we're in the middle of that process. And when we come back to committee at the stage that budgets have been agreed and processes have gone through, I would be more than content to be able to share with you and reflect on the extent to which we have been guided by an awareness of those changes. One thing just in passing about all of this, I've been very keen to say to civil service colleagues meeting with our organisations, cultural organisations, that we are not the only people who are going through this in the cultural and arts world. Every other country in the world is having to grapple with the impact of the pandemic, and many of them are very similar in terms of the impact on obviously a lack of public access to facilities, a drop in income, concern about how one recovers, then how is one intending to recover. And I've been very keen to impress on everybody involved that we should be trying to learn the lessons from elsewhere as well as here. I don't think there will be a monopoly of common sense here, and I'm very keen to work out the best way in which we can learn and then emulate best practice for elsewhere as well. That's again something that I would be happy to feedback, given that we're kind of in this process at the present time, about what we have learned and what we haven't, to make sure that we can do this as well as we can.
Thank you, convener.
Thank you. Can I bring in Mr. Ruskell,
please? Yeah, thanks. You've given us a hint this morning, Cabinet Secretary, about what a cultural recovery could look like and what the benefits could be across society and across, yeah, you know, the work of government. I just wanted to push you a bit more on that, because if you look at the national outcome for culture, it says that we are creative and our vibrant and diverse cultures are expressed and enjoyed widely. Great, great outcome, but it perhaps doesn't describe what, for example, an organisation like Sistema Scotland does, which is much more, I would say, around community regeneration, around health, around ensuring that there's excellent outcomes for school leavers and the whole, you know, regeneration of a community. So I'm just thinking about, in terms of the budget, how do we actually ensure that the wider work of organisations like that is actually captured in the way that budgets are constructed and captured within the national performance framework as well?
Yep. So a very well-timed question, and welcome to the committee. And I think you're aware of the announcement that was made by the Scottish Government in terms of funding for Sistema this week, which I know has been very warmly welcomed by the organisation. For anybody who's watching proceedings, because I'm sure all committee members will know intimately what it is that Sistema does and how it literally transforms the learning experience of younger people. It's an excellent example of something, yes, being primarily a culturally focused intervention, but one which indisputably has an impact on the more general quality of people's lives, and then we hope as a knock-on consequence of their opportunities in life. So the point that you make is in its own way an optimal example of the point that my sneak preview, which you've kindly invited me to show even more of an insight about, which I'm going to have to resist, forgive me, Mr. Ruskell, but just to reiterate the point that, and this is a very good example of it, of projects which have an impact across government responsibility. And I'm very keen that those benefits are understood amongst colleagues whose primary responsibility might be health or might be education or maybe justice. I'm sure many of them are, because we are all parliamentarians who represent a constituency or a region, so we are aware of the impact that some of these projects do. But I think mainstreaming that thinking across government, I genuinely hope, is going to help deliver on the aspirations that we have in the culture strategy and we have in the programme for government. And Sistema is possibly one of the best examples of that. So forgive me, but I'm not going to show any more leg on the creative recovery strategy. I'm sure we will come back to that. And I hope it will be worthy of the ambition, because it should be. I don't know if there's anything that colleagues want to add. No? Okay.
Can I?
Yep.
Yeah. I just wanted to refer to the culture strategy as well, because that was published in February 2020, just before the pandemic, and I think, you know, provides still a very good platform and framework to deliver recovery. So the vision is still relevant, the outcomes that are still relevant, some of the actions need updating, but I think I just wanted to, you know, sort of recognise the culture strategy, because I think stakeholders have worked right across Scotland to over 3 years to produce it, and it's still a very relevant guiding document for recovery.
I suppose Sistema has been an incredible success, and I've been aware of it, of its work in Stirling from the outset. I suppose the question is, there are lots of different organisations, particularly social enterprises, that are creative, that are innovative, that are working around Scotland on town centre regeneration, for example, and taking empty shop fronts and, you know, making these as hubs for creatives to come in and doing some incredible innovative work. But that innovative work doesn't always fit the criteria for, you know, charitable giving or even Creative Scotland. I know a number of organisations like Made in Stirling, for example, which I think the First Minister visited a year or two ago, who really struggled to access funding from Creative Scotland because they don't easily fit the criteria. Because what they're doing is, by in itself, very holistic they're working on regeneration, they're working on multiple outcomes. And I sense that that could be the case for other organisations. They're doing work, say, on health, through music, for example, or other group activities that benefit people with autism. They don't necessarily fit any kind of single funding criteria. So that's really where the buck stops. And I'm interested in how the budget and the cultural strategy will unlock that creativity, because for me this is about 20-minute neighbourhoods and urban regeneration and all the things that we need to happen in our communities.
So I'll answer that in two ways. Firstly, specifically in relation to social enterprises, and the example was given of urban regeneration and so on. The programme for government commits the Scottish Government, and I'm quoting, to recognise the importance of place in Scottish culture and to support communities to celebrate and preserve their heritage. And this year we'll start working on designing a National Towns of Culture scheme to be launched over this Parliament. And that is something that at the present time is being thought about how that can best incorporate the efforts of all kinds of organisations. And it gives an opportunity to listen to advice such as that given by Mr. Ruskell to ensure that the approach to that is as broad as the ambition might be in the cultural recovery strategy to make sure that things are joined up. So I'm taking that down as a mental note and as an action point to make sure, because it's a very specific point in terms of urban and town regeneration and understanding culture in the broadest of senses, it's a very good example. On the second part of the question, I refer back to the much-mentioned, but unable to talk about in greater detail, cultural recovery strategy, which I think... you will be keen to know how tangible the ambition of joined-up government is in including organisations that may, on first reading, not be thought of as being, quote, cultural organisations. And I don't know the answer to that question. I do know that I'm very keen to make it happen, and I'm very keen for my colleagues to be thinking about it. And that is something that I think we can come... No doubt you will want it as a committee to come back and say, is the cultural recovery and renewal strategy fit for purpose? Does it fulfil the ambitions that I shared before the committee and the priorities that you hold as individual members and collectively as a committee? And I think that will be a very worthwhile process when we get to the stage of agreeing it as government and then seeking the views of the likes of this committee.
Okay, thanks.
Thank you very much. If I could possibly ask another supplementary, Cabinet Secretary, as Stem is well known, I have a local organisation who's been working for over 22 years with young people, and they receive the bulk of their funding through the Youth Music Initiative to help do this. I was also convener of the Education and Skills Committee last session of the Parliament when we did the... inquiry into music tuition in schools, and obviously there's a link up now with education. So if we're offering more opportunities for young people to do music at school, is there going to be a review of how the Youth Music Initiative can support both the school and the third sector organisations and that might be picking up some of that work outside school times?
So the first thing, I should declare an interest in all of this, having attended Broughton High School, which is the specialist music school in Scotland's state system, and had the benefit of being a normal school pupil. I wasn't within the music unit as such, but because I was in and around people who were, it was a school which, just in general terms, had tremendous musical aspect to the education of pupils there, which then encouraged some of us, myself included, to play for the Edinburgh Secondary Schools Orchestra. And so I should point out, I'm not claiming to have been a tremendous a violin player at the back of the second violins, but it was great to be part of. But I'm just sharing with you my personal experience that I understand how transformational music in the broadest of senses, is for young people. Why the encouragement for musical tuition and the take-up of music tuition is of importance. And I'm delighted that the Scottish Government and its programme for government included commitments on this, and that they have been taken forward, and they are being taken forward. Another example where you're having this kind of cross-government approach, culture and education. And so you need to know that I am very keen on supporting this, and my officials know that I am very keen to understand how the commitments the Scottish Government were elected on are delivered. And I want to see it go from strength to strength, and for take-up to be possible for kids everywhere, and not just in places where one has the good fortune of where I happen to live, to have a school with a particularly strong musical tradition. There will be places where that's less the case, and we have to make sure that just because of good organisations like Sistema, who will be delivering in amongst the most deprived communities, but there will be other communities who perhaps fall between both of those positions. And we have to try and make sure that we're impacting on young people's lives as best as we can right across the country.
Thank you. I'm going to invite Mr. Cameron to ask his question.
Thank you, Convener. Good morning, Cabinet Secretary and your officials. I'd like to persist with the issue of mainstreaming. So the committee had some really interesting evidence from, I think it was Museums Gallery Scotland, about how museums help encourage health, public health, through various work that they do, as well as education, perhaps more obviously. We've been talking about cross-portfolio working for a long time. It's been 10 years since the Christie Commission was published. And I suppose what I'm trying to drill down to is, how does government really drive this agenda now?
Great question. And here I have to be absolutely clear, as somebody who has been in the Scottish Parliament only since May and a Cabinet Secretary for only a few short months, I do not have the personal insight of the 10-year horizon that Mr. Cameron was talking about. I do know, though, that I spend probably more than half of my working day on Teams calls with colleagues across government discussing how government is joined up. And I certainly get the impression that there's a genuine effort across government to try and make this work, whether that's in the economy. We are about to embark on this in the cultural sphere. And all I can say is that I'm able to reflect on the fact that there is a sincere effort to try and make this work in other areas. I give you the assurance that I am very keen to make sure that this works. You will want to be very sure that it is working. And it's only when we're able to come back and you're able to interrogate the extent to which that's taking place that I can answer that question. But what I can say to you is that it is my intention to try and make it work, and perhaps bringing the experience of the insights of a relative newcomer, perhaps that's helpful. What I do know is that everybody I speak to seems to think it's a tremendously good idea. And that, I think, bodes well, because if there is an awareness, if people weren't aware, let me start from the other way around, if people weren't aware that there are benefits beyond a cultural and arts silo, then we would be in difficulty. The fact that people are recognising the health benefits, the educational benefits, what that might mean for the justice system in certain settings and so on, that makes me very optimistic that if we can harness the awareness and the willingness to do something with it, we can really make that deliver. But you will need to satisfy yourself that that is what is actually going to be able to happen once we have launched the strategy and when we're getting on with delivering it. And again, I go back to this symbiotic relationship and with the committee and government. Maybe I'm a hopelessly idealistic newcomer in this sense as well. You need to know that the work that you do does influence people like me and my civil service colleagues. And so the considerations that you make, because we have different kinds of time constraints and time limitations, for you to be able to take the thoughtful approach you did recently, for example, with your focus group work, is absolutely invaluable. So I just leave that thought back with you, convener and deputy convener. It's a way in which you can really influence ensuring that government delivers, and I'm very keen to work with you on that as we jointly try and deliver something that is joined up.
Thank you for that answer, and I'm grateful for what you just said. I mean, it just strikes me as being something that we all share the ideal, but never quite realise, you know. And I suppose ultimately is how do we get, you know, a GP practice to prescribe, you know, a trip to a museum or a local theatre show, whatever it might be. How do we get that to happen?
I'm
sort of a rhetorical question, but it's.
Well, I mean, I think it's a good kind of question, and we could probably come up with a list of types of questions like that that a joined-up approach could be measured against. I'm not trying to introduce a whole series of new metrics, and I'm looking at my civil service colleagues here, where the speed with which they're writing notes about me, suggesting that we should do it in this way. But the point that you make is a case in point. If people first off the cultural and arts world are to be encouraged to open up pathways for people to have the benefits of our cultural institutions, I suspect that some will be quicker than others to do that. And to what extent does one have to pull, and to what extent does one have to push for that to succeed? We are talking in the small c sense of a cultural change in how we see culture. And again, I can't honestly say that I know exactly how that's going to turn out. I do know that we don't have an alternative, because if that is a benefit, or encouraging kids in particular from deprived communities to learn that cultural institutions and cultural offering is for them as much as it is for anybody else, I reflect on one single statistic that I think Creative Scotland deduced from some of its research, which was that only 30% of people know how to access information about cultural events, which is probably surprising for us who do go to things and we know where to look. But if we take that at face value, we have to accept that the disconnect with a significant part of society is profound. And that's why the doctor prescribing or encouraging or the school that is able to help their kids go to places that they would never normally go and instill in them the sense that it's something worth going back to and encouraging going with their parents, we have to get all of that joined up. And like I said, there isn't an alternative. And again, that's an example of which, if you know, good thinking on your part will help encourage us think about how it is that we're going to be able to deliver this across government.
Thank you. Could I move now to a completely different area, which is about the spread of funding across local authority areas? And we received evidence from Creative Scotland a few weeks ago, in which it emerged that there is a very disparate spread of funding. So, for instance, in terms of per capita funding, Edinburgh gets £51 per capita, Glasgow 34, Dundee 21, Aberdeen £4.67, and the five areas with the lowest per capita funding are all the areas surrounding Edinburgh and Glasgow. So there seems to be a huge variety. Now, I appreciate Creative Scotland is an arm's length organisation, and there is an issue about the amount of applications that are made and then how many awards are then made thereafter. But what can government do to kind of encourage a greater spread of funding, greater range of applications, number of applications, and then funding awards across Scotland? Because it does seem to be a sort of huge variety.
Yeah. Well, firstly, there's a conceptual point in understanding the feedback that's been made in that question. I think everybody here will appreciate that because a particular body is headquartered in Edinburgh, for sake of argument, doesn't mean that all of its cultural work is undertaken in Edinburgh. We've got cultural organisations that lay great store on the fact that they tour. And that isn't borne out in the headline figures of the dispersal of funds to particular organisations, because it creates the impression, doesn't it, that all of the money is centred on Edinburgh, for example, which is not the case. And I say this as somebody who lived for a great length of time in the north of Scotland and was able to enjoy all kinds of national companies and others who were headquartered in Edinburgh or in Glasgow, performing in the Universal Hall in Findhorn or Elgin Town Hall. These are things that I enjoyed. And it underlines the point that I think we have to be a little bit careful in understanding this point about where is money dispersed to. That's point one. Point two, how do we encourage organisations that are currently not funded to seek funding? And that goes back to something that we were discussing right at the start, isn't it? So I don't want to go around the houses again on that. One thing that you might be able to help us with is understand, are there a slew of organisations that would wish to be funded that are based somewhere else who are not being funded and for a particular reason? Is that so? If it is, I would like to know about it, because I do not have the sense of a systemic underfunding of organisations based elsewhere. Observation one. Observation two, is it the case that some cultural organisations could perhaps do more work elsewhere in the country? Undeniably, that's probably the case. Mr. Cameron will know that funding streams have been made available and are being dispersed right now for performers and people in the arts scene to be able to reach different parts of the country. And I would encourage anybody who's listening to this who wants to do that to do that. So point one is a conceptual point. It's not all money is not just spent in the local authorities where the organisations are headquartered. Two, I'm not aware that there are a whole series of organisations which are not funded or underfunded who are based elsewhere. And thirdly, let's make sure that we are reaching the whole of the country. I don't know if there are colleagues sitting next to me who've got anything to add. David, no?
Thank you.
No? Good. I've covered that.
Thank you.
Okay.
Thank you. Okay. Ms. Mintel?
Great, thank you, Convener, and thank you for coming to see us today. I'd just like to go back actually to Donald Cameron's first question. I actually have a friend who's a retired GP who would love to have been able to prescribe hugging a tree or going to a cultural event, but I think there's also a requirement to change people's perception of what they get when they go to the GPs. And in some respects, perhaps the pandemic has actually opened up some different doors. I had the privilege of attending an art show in Oban, which actually resulted from work that people had been doing through the pandemic. So I think sprouting up throughout Scotland, there are these kind of ideas, and that is something that I hope that we, as elected people and in government, can actually expand on. I'd like to go back to one of the things that you said in your opening statement, Cabinet Secretary, about the screen industry in Scotland and the vibrancy of it. Clearly, studio in Leith, in Glasgow as well, and then we also have the BBC across Scotland as well, and Channel 4. So interested to know how how the budget is looking at supporting the skills there, but also locations across Scotland as well, our wonderful scenery, for example.
Well, thank you very much. I would be happy to do the entire evidence session on this particular area, because I think it's something that we should all be very, very encouraged and excited about. The first point on funding, well, this is the remit of Screen Scotland that is funded through Creative Scotland, which is funded by the Scottish Government, and we lay great store on what is happening. And we are, as an organisation, and I am personally very, very enthused about the quality of the organisation, firstly, Screen Scotland, and what it is currently doing, what it is able to do with the resources that it has, and what it is that we are currently and are planning to do. So going into a few of those things, I've got a number in front of me that tells me that we have been funding production growth, so having more film and television projects undertaken in Scotland. The fund has been running since 2015, and £9.9 million has been funded from that. The estimated economic benefit to Scotland as a return is £140 million. So if we want to understand the benefit of government helping to encourage this particular sector is massive. And so that's point one. Point two, studios were mentioned. We have gone from a position 10 years ago where we literally didn't have a single one to having facilities in Edinburgh that were mentioned in Bath Road. We have them in West Lothian, which are being used for Omen 2. We have facilities in Cumbernauld that are being used for Outlander. We have facilities in Glasgow that are at the BBC, and we're very pleased that's remaining within the BBC structure. And we have Kelvin Hall, where the Scottish Government has put a lot of money in, and for very, very good reasons, to be able to produce there. And what is hugely encouraging about that is, notwithstanding the fact that we now have these sites which are being used and are being booked back to back, we are having further interest and a demand for further facilities. And I mean, I think the opportunity for this in Scotland is something that we absolutely need to grab with both hands. Now, there are aspects to this which are perhaps less obvious than what we might read in the newspapers. We might read in the newspapers that we might see another big ticket film taking place in Scotland, and I'm looking forward to as much of that happening as possible. But understanding what happens below that and what Scottish Government and our agencies can do is going to be key in ensuring that the benefit of this development is realised as widely as it can be. And in that context, it is around skills and training that we have, in some respects, the most exciting prize of all to make. And so the Scottish Government puts funding in through Screen Scotland and in through other funding routes to different skills training. And here's another example of where we need to be joined up as we can be in government. So we have, for example, Screen Scotland doing what it's doing, and skills being developed through them. We then have, for example, and I just reflect on it because I had a conversation with the principal of Napier University about it this very week, a creative centre that Napier University has, which is developing skills which are mission critical for the screen sector. And then we have Edinburgh College, and this is the bit that we cannot overlook, and this is really, really important, that are developing craft skills so that when productions come here, we have people who are able to do the set building, for example. That means you need brickies and plasterers who can work in a film environment. it is very well paid work. But you need people who have experience to work in that kind of situation to be able to do this. Now, I had the good fortune to be able to visit Bath Road during the filming of The Rig. I mean, the set was incredible. It was huge. That's one of the advantages of the facilities. It can. I mean, I was watching them a helicopter landing indoors in a studio. I mean, it's amazing what they can do. But it was put to me that one of the reasons why they were able to do a production like that was they were able to use the workforce from the Lyceum Theatre that was not operating at the time, because of COVID lockdown. Okay, so that in that sense, it's a happy circumstance because the people who work in set design in the Lyceum were able to continue working. But what happens when the Lyceum is back up and working and the next production, Anansi Boys at Bath Road, I'm sure they have great people who are doing this, but I'm just trying to illustrate that one of the things that, well, we need to do in government and you can help with in fostering an understanding that this industry, if we get this right, we are supporting more productions coming here. We're helping to provide the facilities to emerge out of market failure, which we have had in the past. That we're working with broadcasters, streaming services, and other commissioners to bring more work here, mm-hmm. and we're doing what we need to do to provide people with the skills to be able to support that production. Now, if we get all of that right, that's a virtuous circle. And yes, Scotland has amazing scenery that is a backdrop to films, but the even bigger prize for us as technology develops the way it is it's not just, although there's plenty that we would wish Scotland to be the backdrop represented in films, of course, it is the filming, frankly, of anything set anywhere that we are going to be able to do here. And that is a massive prize for us as a cultural offering. And then there's the additional point that I'd like to put a marker down on. We have exported our brightest and best in this industry for decades. And whether it's the talent that we all know, just think of all of those Scottish performers who are now based in New York or Los Angeles, or London for that matter, but then there's all the people that you might actually not know, all of the directors and the producers and all of the people who work on the shop floor, so to speak, who have gone where the work has taken them. We now have the prize of a full through-life career opportunity based here. So, sorry, I've spoken for quite a while about that, convener. I could speak longer about it, but I hope I'm giving you a flavour of the fact that I think this is something that is going to be transformational. It's a new string to our bow when we come to culture and the arts in Scotland, and we should grab it with both hands. And anything that you find on in your work which suggests there are things that we should be doing more of or less of or in a different way, I'd be very happy to hear that.
Thank you for that. I look forward to the sequel. As you know, I represent Argyll and Bute, and it's thinking about getting some of the spend and the skills yep. development just out with the central belt as well, and looking at the colleges and universities there to support skills development. And you're absolutely right. Everything from makeup to set design to floor management, et cetera, is all needed, the support. Also, I was very struck by a lot of the evidence that we took about the importance of culture out with the Central Belt as well. And I know that Donald Cameron touched on that too. So I was heartened to hear some of your comments with regards to that. But I suppose just to underline the importance of small community groups, small museums, and what they add to the community, and that shouldn't, and also visitors to the areas, and that shouldn't be forgotten in the Scottish Government's budgeting process.
It's a point well made and well noted. I would just give one example of the fact that our cultural producers are not just based in our cities, and I pray and aid the fact that one of the biggest movers and shakers behind Omens 2 is based in Skye, as a good example of the fact that it is perfectly possible to be a talented writer or a director or many of the other skills that that Jenny Minto has highlighted and can still work in this sector, because we are a small country. And that is one of the advantages that we have. So one of the other things that comes into my mind when reflecting on this is it underlines the importance of commissioning in Scotland. And this is where the likes of Channel 4, having one of their commissioning hubs in Glasgow, has great potential, because it means having somebody on the ground that understands the independent sector, in the case of Channel 4, because that's mm-hmm. what they do, they commission from others to produce content for them. If you have people on the ground, yes, they are headquartered in Glasgow, but they should, and I know they do know, and they are interested in the skills that there are throughout the country. And that's why the importance of receiving commitments from, in this case, public service broadcasters, UK-based public service broadcasters, whether that's Channel 4 or BBC or others, to commission in Scotland is very important. And I have been impressing on their chief executives that this is the case and this should be the case. And incidentally, is one of the concerns that I have, and I'm sure a number of you in this committee also have, about the prospects for the future of Channel 4. Channel 4 is privatised in the way that is proposed, changes the model under which it operates without any guarantees for the protection of the likes of the commissioning structure that we now, for the first time, have based in Scotland, we have the potential to lose the gains that I've been outlining. And that's one of the key reasons why I really hope the UK government reconsiders. They've reconsidered before, so hopefully they will understand now, with points like this being made, if one's wanting to make sure that different parts of the United Kingdom are seeing the benefits of screen and television and production and so on, and one is wanting to, quote, level up in a variety of places, doing so in a way that is going to see the cutting of that that footprint in different parts of the UK will be very, very detrimental.
Thank you. Mr. Ruskell?
I'm interested in what you're saying about those phenomenal opportunities to bring production to Scotland. And I'm just thinking about the rest of your portfolio and Scottish Government's aspiration to develop its footprint, its linkage out to the rest of the world, particularly new hubs that you're planning to set up. Does that feed directly into the work that Screen Scotland need to do to reach out and to bring production in, as well as ensuring that the best Scottish talent can move and take part in productions abroad as well?
So absolutely. And let me start in a place that people might not have thought of. We could start in the United States. I'm not going to. I'm going to come back to the United States in a moment. I've been discussing with some members of the committee the likes of the Scottish Government's plans for an expansion of our network, which includes Copenhagen and includes Warsaw. So let me give you a really concrete example in this area where the likes of a direct presence in Copenhagen matters. You don't need to be the biggest fan of Scandi Noir to understand that in recent years, one of the most successful broadcasters in the world to produce content has been DR, which is a Danish public broadcaster. What they have been able to do individually and in co-production, often with their Swedish and Norwegian neighbours, is to produce content, incidentally, in a language spoken by only 5 million people, which we've all been enjoying from, you know, Bonn, forgive my Danish pronunciation, but Bonn and The Bridge and a variety of other series, which have been massive hits. There's a classic example of why I think, and notwithstanding all the other sensible reasons for us having a presence in the Nordic and Baltic regions, where we can learn from the best practice of a country that has been tremendously successful, what is it that they have been doing that has meant that a country the same size as Scotland, with a national broadcaster, which we don't have in the same way, has been able to make commercially successful productions and export them. Number one place I want to learn from is Denmark. So having a presence in Copenhagen is a very, very, very good idea. Of course, it's much more than that. And having a presence in the United States, there's a Scottish Government office in Washington, D.C., which works very closely with the SDI presence that we have in various other bits of the United States. And there's, in addition to that, Screen Scotland regularly has a presence in the United States where it is dealing directly with people in the film industry about the changing landscape, if you want to call it that, of screen production in Scotland. So that operates, but based on the basis that we have a permanent representation, we have a wider network, it's joined up with Scottish Government, it's joined up with our agencies. And then there's an additional thought that fits in with my portfolio, which relates to our diaspora. Part of our diaspora includes some of the most successful people in film and television in the world. They just happen not to be based here. And we know we have great fortune in that I pluck a name, somebody like Brian Cox, one week can be making a hit series in Succession, for example, and the next week he can be filming something in Dundee for BBC Scotland because he's personally committed to that. Mm-hmm. And I want to make sure that people in our diaspora who work in this sector are fully aware of what is going on here, because a great many of them have moved and have semi-permanently moved somewhere else, and you know that's the life choices that they've made. They've had the good fortune to work in an industry that's taken them to LA or wherever it is. But these are people who operate in a sector where they have great influence and are able to help promote in their own way what we are doing here, and that's something else that's on my list. So yes, the formal work, yes, the having the greater footprint, yes, that is a key part of our endeavour of what it is that they will be able to add, and then it's using the networks of people who are part of the Scottish diaspora or are affinity Scots who play part of... Sorry, just another thought on that. The number of people who have come to Scotland in recent years who have made films or made television series, who are not from here, who have gone back to wherever it is they've come from, the praise that they share with their colleagues that they go back to is immense. And we need to do everything that we can to capitalise on that goodwill that we see growing in the film and TV industry to get maximum effect in Scotland. It's massive upside at the moment, and I would encourage you again to develop your interest in it.
Thank you. Mr. Golden.
Thank you, convener. Just thinking around events organisations and theatres who are most dependent on earned income through in-person attendance, and they've obviously been significantly impacted throughout the pandemic, and it's great to see them being able to return to performances, and I'm sure everyone will enjoy the panto season. But my main question is, there is still a degree of natural uncertainty and a real weak appetite to take risk, to book a show for next year and in their long-term planning. And I wonder how the Scottish Government could help to support them to make production bookings and assist with that long-term planning.
Okay, so my first point, I understand, Mr. Golden was attending another committee at the beginnings of proceedings, and it's now you're a new member of the committee, I believe, so welcome to the committee. Look forward to working with you. At the beginning, I made a statement where I outlined the massive Scottish Government spending that has been undertaken, which in great measure is way beyond the funding levels that we've received in consequentials from the UK government. So our ambition to try and put the funding in place to support recovery right across the cultural sector has been given, and there are Mr. Golden will understand this, there are a number of funding streams that are available, and I do appreciate that there are different venues that are treated in different ways, and so some may feel more uncertain than others. I totally understand that. Forgive me, I don't know if the point that I'm about to make is one that I made before or after he was able to take part in proceedings, but I think one of the things that lies in our hands is trying to encourage the speediest recovery of the arts and culture scene as fast as possible. And it does worry me. I've seen some organisations thinking that they won't get back to the financial position that they were pre-pandemic for up to 5 years. Now, seems to me that we should be doing as much as we can to minimise that time as much as possible. We have made funding streams available as those come to the end of their natural life. We have to think about the resources that we have, about whether there is any targeting that is required in specific areas. So if Mr. Golden has examples, I'm very keen to hear where, if there's any gap between the intention of funding streams and the delivery for mm-hmm. particular outlets, very keen to hear that. But one of the things that I'm very seized on is, what is it that we can do that it can encourage maximum public take up of the cultural offering that we have? So whether that's pantomime season or the Edinburgh International Festival, it matters not. What does matter is that people go and people feel that they're safe and that our cultural offering is able to bounce back. If there's anything, I noticed in his question, Mr. Golden was asking specifically around booking. Mm-hmm. I'm not sure whether there's anything behind that that he wants to add. But I think anything that government and government agencies can do to encourage participation in and support of the cultural offering, I think is a large part of our way out of this. Government doesn't do culture. It is for us to help support people who do culture, if that makes sense. Mm-hmm. And I'm very keen that we are as innovative as we can be to drive up cultural participation, and that for organisations then means more people in theatres, more people at events, more income, and a quicker financial recovery. And in the meantime, we are continuing to fund to a significant degree to help venues and organisations find their feet again.
Thank you, Cabinet yep. Secretary. I'd like to explore another area, just to pick up on partnership working, and particularly around local authorities, because we've looked at, if you like, Creative Scotland funding yep. on a geographical basis, but I wonder what your thoughts would be on having mandatory local authority cultural reporting and publishment of a strategy so that there's transparency, and we can also see on a geographic basis which local authorities are proactively embracing culture to embed it into communities.
So the first thing in reviewing some of the figures before I came to the committee, I observed that in general terms, cultural spending by local authorities has remained, which I think is positive in my commendations to people in local government, because I know they have a lot of demand on their budgets. There is always an opportunity for partnership working. I would put down one marker in this again, having said what I said in a moment ago to Mr. Golden about it. You know, it's not for the Scottish Government to do culture. We support culture. We help culture. Our cultural organisations are much closer to the front line, and having that arm's length separation is there for a reason. I'm sure Mr. Golden would be the first to tell me that he wouldn't think it's a good idea for local government to be directed and to have their ability to make budget priorities and decisions themselves. I note he was talking about publishing and having an understanding of. I definitely think there's something in that. Of course, we answer questions in the usual way about information that the Scottish Government holds. I'd need to defer to colleagues about the degree of understanding that we have on a council-to-council level. That would be answered through partnership working and with the Convention of Scottish Local Authorities, and I think that would be hugely valuable. I'm sure a lot of that happens at present. Is there anything else that colleagues want to add on that point?
I think the only thing to say is that we did meet with the cultural conveners earlier this year. We're intending to meet more to find out what we can do with what more we can do with local authorities. But I think, just as Cabinet Secretary has said, local authorities do spend £577 million over 2021 on sort of cultural activity. So I think it's something that they do take seriously.
I would just add to that, though, that, and this is, again, another little yellow post-it note for us to take away in relation to our cultural recovery and renewal strategy, is exactly the point that Mr. Golden makes, is about cooperation, and that whilst it would obviously be a good thing that we are thinking right across the Scottish Government on how culture and the arts is mainstreamed in all of our thinking, there's absolutely no reason why we wouldn't include that broader understanding or encourage that broader understanding to also involve local authorities who do have a delivery responsibility and, you know, do deliver, as my colleague has just pointed out, a significant amount of money on culture. So that's another little yellow post-it note from me and colleagues.
Okay. Thank you, Cabinet Secretary. Thank you, Convener.
Thank you. I suppose it's worth just noting that, of course, the alleys in local government are quite different across the country as well. So it makes having previous experience of trying to drill down on these areas, it can be problematic. I think I have a final supplementary from Ms. Boyack.
Thanks very much, Convener. I've actually missed the last few minutes, so I really appreciate getting in. Just to add for the Cabinet Secretary's information, a few weeks ago when we were taking evidence, we got a really interesting suggestion about how we support freelancers and making stronger links with schools and local communities. And the suggestion was it'd be good both in terms of access to culture, but also sustaining employment locally. And you already mentioned your own experience in school. So that issue about skills and confidence, that access to musicians and artists gives young people at school is really important. So it's more just to add it to your conversation with colleagues over the next few weeks when you're discussing budget issues, and I don't know if it's potentially even linked into the percent for art idea. Thanks very much for letting me back in, Convener.
Can I just say,
I'm not expecting a lengthy answer today.
No, I'm not going to give a lengthy answer to Sarah Boyack, but I think her point and her intervention is very well timed and is very well made. I speak as somebody who, amongst my circle of friends, I have, I'm trying to think, at least one person who works in the cultural scene as a freelancer in the arts environment and delivers his work to younger people, to older people in care settings, to in other environments. And I think we need to make sure that what we are able to do that will ensure that freelancers are able to fully take part in the cultural recovery and renewal process is something that should definitely be part of our considerations. I should probably have declare an interest in that point, that I wouldn't be making decisions like this to benefit any friend that I may have that's active in the scene. But I say that all of that with a smile on my face. But I think that the point in general is well made, and we want to make sure, because one of the experiences that we had, particularly at the beginning of the COVID experience, was people who were freelancers finding out that they were not covered in one way or another with government support measures, and which is another reason why we need to take this away and make sure that we are thinking as well as we can about them and what it is that they do and what it is that they offer. Thank you.
Okay. I think Mr. Ruskell has one very final small question.
A last word.
Final post-it note, Convener. I think a lot of what you've discussed with us this morning, Cabinet Secretary, has been about well-being, and you've heard, obviously, you know, a lot of comments from members as well on that. I guess I'm interested for the future as to how government will reflect on culture's contribution towards a well-being economy, and whether that's through the well-being bill, whether it's through consideration of a Future Generations Commissioner, for example. I mean, I've been very struck by the work of the Welsh Future Generations Commissioner in relation to the Welsh language, Perhaps that's for consideration and further reflection, but any early thoughts you have around those two pieces of work which the Scottish Government is committed to looking at?
Well, it has to be committed to all of them, surely. If our ambition is to be joined up, if our ambition is to mainstream thinking about culture and the arts and the way that it impacts across government, it should really form consideration in all of the work that we do. And are we making the most of that, and are we encouraging an understanding of that? There was, I mean, just to finish off a thought, and not just because it's a member of the Green Party that's asking the question, there was a sort of slightly tongue-in-cheek description of prescribing the culture and the arts as hugging trees. And I know that was meant as that was meant humorously and was not meant as a serious point, but I just reflect on the fact that if we were discussing culture and the arts in relation to health 10, 15, 20 years ago, it would have seemed like a rather odd or out of place suggestion. It is now not. Thank goodness. And that's why I know that the comment was being made humorously around the issue of the health benefits of culture and the arts. But it just makes the point, I think we are ready as a culture, all of us, regardless of our different politics, to understand that this does play an important role. And I think we're just at the start of this parliamentary session. I think this will probably be the parliamentary session that really does begin to make this happen. And that encourages and enthuses me, as I'm sure it does you.
Yeah. I think that concludes questions this morning, Cabinet Secretary. Thank you very much for your attendance, and to Mr. Sears and Ms. Sisland as well for their attendance this morning. We'll now move into private session.